Almost 2 years ago, I created the Potato Masher. Born from a joking challenge on the Casual Shenanigans Gaming Podcast, my only original goal was to see if I could build a PC that could beat a PS4 for about the same money. I never thought it would go beyond a few thousand views, and I thought I would make a few follow-up videos and then move on. Well, 82 videos later, and here we are. This is going to be a long video with a lot of separate parts. Seriously, I'm not skimping on the details here. I also apologize it's taking this long to get the video out. Life is pretty swamped right now, and I didn't want to make a 5-minute video. You guys have been invested for almost 2 years now, and you deserve the details. For those of you who like minutia, buckle in. For everyone else, the time codes are right there in the description. Feel free to skip around to whatever interests you. Since this series has grown much larger than I ever thought realistic, I'd like to take this opportunity to clarify a few things. Yes, I do prefer PC gaming, and I do believe it's the objectively superior platform, but it's not the perfect fit for everyone. I just want to show you what's possible with budget PC gaming, because so few good YouTube channels and tech sites cover that. Sure, the newest and best graphics cards makes for cool headlines and they drive traffic, but you don't have to spend $1,000 to $2,000 to have a great PC gaming experience. I've also owned almost every console sold in the last 15 years, and I've enjoyed them all. I especially like PlayStation. I bought a PS3 when they launched at $600, if that tells you anything about how much I like PlayStation, which is maybe more than I should have back then. The Potato Masher series is not me trying to convince people not to buy a console. It's about me testing the long-term value of both systems to give you, the consumer, more information you can use to make your own decision. I'm on your side. If you watch all my videos and decide a PS4 or PS4 Pro is the right fit for you, I'm 100% fine with that. If you win, I win. However, there's a lot of sketchy PR spin coming from Sony about the capabilities of their new system, and on forums and comment sections I'm watching consumers eat it up with a healthy dose of the placebo effect. I'm going to see what I can do to ground some of the conversation and provide some context for interested PS4 owners who are just dipping their toes into high-resolution gaming. Do I enjoy it when the Potato Masher is way better than the PS4? Sure, I won't apologize for that, but both are very capable gaming systems and you can't go wrong with either. It's all about finding what's best for you. So, when the PS4 Pro was announced, I made a couple videos talking about it and my options for pitting the Potato Masher against it. Regardless of whether the commenters were primarily PC or console gamers, the overwhelming majority of the comments I received from you guys said the same few things. First, you care a lot more about how the PS4 Pro runs games at 1080p and 60Hz than 4K. This makes sense, as relatively few people have 4K TVs or monitors, and the majority of gamers use 1080p screens, regardless of their platform of choice. Also, until a company like Elgato or Avermedia release a decently priced 4K 60fps capture card, I can't record the PS4 Pro at 4K without making some compromises that would significantly degrade capture quality, which isn't fair at all. So for now, the bulk of my comparisons will focus on 1080p and 60Hz. And of course, there's no way to actually record and display HDR content in a way that any of you could appreciate right now because technology isn't there. So we're just setting HDR completely aside for the time being. This is also appropriate because I don't consider the PS4 Pro or this new revision of the Potato Masher to be fully capable 4K gaming machines. They both will deliver great 1080p experiences with a nice entry point into high-resolution gaming for people who are interested but aren't ready to commit to $1,000 or more for a true native 4K gaming rig. Both platforms are very capable of native 4K experiences in quite a few games, but they also will need to utilize resolution scaling and careful graphics optimizations in others. So while I will factor 4K or 1440p performance into my comparisons, it will always be in the context of providing a better than 1080p experience, however that makes sense for that particular game. Next, you are more interested in seeing how an upgraded version of the Potato Masher competes against the PS4 Pro, instead of me making a completely separate build. Most of the reasons you all gave me revolved around the PS4 Pro not being a massive upgrade to the PS4, and you'd rather me wait and put my next big effort into the next generational leap, whether that's the Scorpio or the PS5 or whatever. You also thought it would be interesting to see how much money it costs to upgrade from a PS4 to a PS4 Pro, and what that same amount of money could get you with the Potato Masher. And lastly, a lot of you are most interested in the Potato Masher staying as is, or competing against the PS4 as is, so anything I decided to do with the PS4 Pro would have to not mess up the main series. I wholeheartedly agree. Today, I'd like to introduce you to the Potato Masher Pro. It's the Potato Masher, just like you're used to, just with a different video card. As a reminder, here are the Potato Masher specs. Not bad for late 2014 and less than $400, right? Well, for the Potato Masher Pro, I'll be swapping to a new GPU for major AAA releases to test the Potato Masher Pro against the PS4 Pro. I'm sure I'm going to get some confused comments in the future, so you guys feel free to link them to this explanation starting right now. The Potato Masher Pro is going to be a series where I test how much value you can get for your money when you just upgrade your GPU. I'm approaching this from the angle of someone who bought a PS4, really likes the ecosystem, but wishes it had a bit more power. They see the PS4 Pro announced, they sell their PS4, and they take that money and pitch in a bit more and get a PS4 Pro. I'm going to use the same line of thought and spend the same amount of money or less to get a GPU upgrade for the Potato Masher. Changing nothing else, how will the two platforms compare? And no, I don't know if I could buy all these exact same parts for the same price as buying a new PS4 Pro. I mean, I believe I could buy comparable parts for the same money, and I did price out several complete demo builds before I decided on doing this particular series, but that's not exactly what I'm doing here. You also have to keep in mind that I bought most of these parts 2 years ago, so their prices are no longer the same. Some things like the motherboard are way harder to find these days, so I'd probably pick quite a few different parts if I was doing this build in late 2016. You can't directly compare the prices I paid then and how much this stuff is all worth now, just like you can't directly compare what PS4s sold for then and now. But you can compare the sunk cost necessary to achieve the same result, which is exactly what I'm doing with this series. So no, to anyone watching and wondering, this is not a standalone $400 build. It's likely worth a little more than $400, but certainly within $30 or $40 max. Less than a year of PS Plus or one AAA game if you're eyeing doing something similar and you're worried about the cost. Got it? Alright, cool, let's talk money. So, here's how I decided how much money to spend on this GPU upgrade to create the Potato Masher Pro. My wife has, or had, one of the mid-cycle upgrade PS4s. You know, the ones with the quieter fans and the matte case. With all its accessories, and averaging it out with a few other similar PS4s online to account for some random variation, I was able to clear about $210 online after all applicable fees. Not bad at all, and a bit better than the $150 to $200 some stores would give you on a trade-in. So, I needed to add $190 to that to buy a $400 PS4 Pro. Actually, after taxes, I paid $420 for my PS4 Pro, but let's pretend like I bought it somewhere with no tax. So, $190 to upgrade to a PS4 Pro. Now, I didn't actually sell the GTX 760 and the Potato Masher because I need it for the main series, but they sell for an average of $73 on eBay right now. That's the reference cooler 2GB model, which is what I have. So if I sold it and added that money to the $190 I spent to upgrade to the PS4 Pro, I would have $263 to buy a new GPU for the Potato Masher while spending the same overall amount. And remember, that's with me getting a good price on my PS4 instead of a crummy trade-in deal, and that's not counting taxes on the PS4 Pro, and that's assuming I'm not buying a 4K TV or anything else along with either of these purchases. So, what does $263 get you? Well, originally I was thinking about a GTX 1060 3GB model, when I thought I'd have closer to $220 to spend. Then, I settled on a RX 480 4GB model, because I do like rooting for AMD and it could be fun for DirectX 12 and Vulkan comparisons. But, in the last month or so, GPU prices have been in steep competition. Both AMD and Nvidia have dropped prices on a number of cards and there are retailer sales going on everywhere. I even bought a nice aftermarket Sapphire 4GB RX 480 for $200. Actually, my friend Dave bought it, I was on vacation, but I was really excited about using it in the build, and then 2 days later I bought a Gigabyte GTX 1060 6GB G1 Edition for $230. That's shipped, no rebates, no mail-in offers, no weirdness. $230 out the door. That's crazy. GTX 1060 3GB models have been going for less than $180, and I've seen RX 480s for about the same amount. It's a great time to buy a GPU for 1080p gaming, that's for sure. It's also crazy how much power you can get for so cheap. The 6GB 1060 is very comparable to the GTX 980, only with more VRAM. It has a TDP of only 120 watts, less than the Masher's current 170 watt GTX 760. It uses less power, it's quieter, and it has a much better cooler. All of this lets it overclock like a champ. The G1 Edition is already factory overclocked, but I bumped the core up another 130 MHz and the memory 600 MHz. That's not the card's overclocking limit, but it's close enough to it that pushing it farther wouldn't get me much more real-world performance, and this way it still stays quiet and cool. Now, this is a great card, but it's not that much more powerful than the PS4 Pro's theoretical GPU power. But while the PS4 Pro has also received a slight CPU overclock, the Masher's CPU can't go any higher with the budget cooler I'm using, so it's going to stay the same. The rest of the Masher's parts are also starting to be a bit dated, so it'll be interesting to see if they can give the GTX 1060 enough support to give us a great experience. I'm going to compare this against the PS4 Pro, of course, but first let's start with some benchmarks comparing the Potato Masher Pro against the original Potato Masher configuration, so you can see how much faster the Pro is. Up first is Unigine Heaven. The Potato Masher scored 832 on the Ultra Quality preset, which is actually slightly better than it did when I first built it. The Potato Masher Pro scored 1611. In 3D Mark Firestrike, the Masher scored 5,702, while the Masher Pro scored 10,206. Not bad, and again, almost twice as fast. The last synthetic test is 3D Mark TimeSpy, where the Masher scored 1,763 and the Masher Pro scored 3,889. However, synthetics aren't real-world performance, so I also polled you guys on Twitter and I've picked some games to retest. Up first will be benchmarks, and these will not be run at the same settings I used in the original Potato Masher video for each game. These tests are not about getting smooth, playable results, they're about pushing the system as hard as I can and then seeing how much better the Masher Pro is. So I'm not going to break down all the settings I used, I'm just going to pick really high presets and make the Masher cry. Then I'm going to see what type of playable settings the Masher Pro can hit in those games, so I'll optimize the settings a little and get some smoother footage for you to look at. All of these benchmarks are run without VSync or frame rate limiting, of course, so you'll see more spikes than you would in regular gameplay, both in the maximum and minimum FPS. Lastly, if you're new to one of my videos, I normalize games' graphics settings to a 5-tiered scale. Very low, low, medium, high, and very high. Let's look at some games. So here's one of the downsides of the PS4 Pro. While more power is great, developers will have to patch older games to support the Pro, otherwise games will run just the same as they did on the PS4. On PC, you don't need a developer's express permission to go back and play older games at higher settings. You just upgrade your hardware and play whatever you want. The Witcher 3 is very deserving of a patch, but CD Projekt Red has said they are going to devote their resources to newer projects and they aren't planning a patch, which of course is their right. Novigrad is one of the most demanding areas in the game, and it's very CPU heavy. Riding through a section of town for 1 minute and at 1080p and very high settings, the Masher averaged 29 FPS and had a max of 35, while the Masher Pro averaged 54 FPS and had a max of 69. Repeating the same test at 1440p, the Masher struggled with an average of just 20 FPS with a max of 23, while the Masher Pro averaged 46 and had a max of 52. At 4K and medium settings, the Masher averaged 14 FPS with a max of 15, and the Masher Pro averaged 30 with a max of 33. This is one of the most taxing areas of the game that I've found, so it's a worst case scenario for both system configurations, but the Masher Pro still performs very well. Setting aside benchmarks, in the original Witcher 3 video, the Masher couldn't sustain 60 FPS at any settings at 1080p. At very high settings on the Masher Pro, it stays near 60 FPS, but does have quite a few frame rate drops into the 50s. Dropping to high settings, and the Masher stays at 60 FPS in almost every scenario. Besides a few momentary drops in the busiest areas of Novigrad, it's a rock-solid 60 all the time. The CPU is getting absolutely hammered, and that probably means the PS4 Pro couldn't hit 60 FPS in this game. Open world games are notoriously hard on CPUs. The Masher was able to hit 1440p and medium settings at 30 FPS with a few drops. At those same settings, the Masher Pro maintains a locked 60 in all the rural areas, and it drops to around 57 or 58 occasionally in busy towns. At very high settings, the Masher Pro also has no trouble with maintaining a locked 30 FPS at 1440p, and the game does look gorgeous. Still, I've gotta try 4K, right? Well, at medium settings and 30 FPS, Toussaint looks like a beautiful watercolor painting. This game truly has some of the best art design I think I've ever seen, and 4K resolution really brings out the depth and clarity of CDPR's vision. YouTube really doesn't do this game justice. Now, my personal PC with its GTX 980 Ti can't do 4K and 60 FPS at any settings, so of course the Masher Pro can't either. However, the PS4 Pro is going to be relying on resolution scaling for quite a few of its 4K games, so is that an option here? Well, here's 4K in very low settings. It tops out around 45 FPS. Now here's the Masher Pro at 1620p. It can hit 60 FPS with more resolution detail than 1440p, but it's still at very low settings. The pop-in and foliage look pretty bad, and the lighting's a lot flatter than at some of the other presets. So if you had this configuration and wanted 60 FPS, I would stick to 1440p even if you upscale it to a 4K screen. 1440p is about 78% more pixels than 1080p, although it still has a ways to go before it reaches the detail of native 4K. So in The Witcher 3, the Masher Pro delivers an outstanding experience with real playable 4K and excellent 1440p performance, not to mention doing an amazing job at 1080p. Here it is, the most popular game I've ever tested on the Potato Masher and one of the best-selling games of all time. There has also not been a PS4 Pro patch announced for this game yet, but it'd be great to see one in the future and you guys really wanted to see me retest it. In the original Potato Masher video, I heavily optimized the settings, but it was still an average of the high preset at 1080p. For these benchmarks, I'm not. That means the really demanding NVIDIA shadows are on, along with really high population density and everything else. Remember, this is a torture test. So at 1080p during the opening mission where Franklin and Lamar are stealing cars, the Masher averaged 45 FPS and had a max of 76. The Masher Pro averaged 90 FPS and had a max of 149. It's kind of funny how close the Masher Pro is to exactly doubling the Masher's performance. At 1440p in high settings, the Masher averaged 27 FPS and had a max of 41. The Masher Pro averaged 82 and had a max of 125. Because I like it when the Masher cries, I tested 4K in high settings as well. The Masher creaked in with an average of 12 FPS and a max of 15, not really playable, while the Masher Pro averaged 49 FPS and had a max of 58. Thank much higher memory bandwidth for such a huge disparity at 4K. So how about playable settings? If you have a 1080p screen and want the absolute best image quality, here's the Masher Pro with everything cranked. Crazy grass settings, super soft shadows, every high resolution shadow streaming option, you name it. GTA 5 has a ton of options that really aren't designed even for modern PCs, and you can push it really, really far. I mean, 30 FPS isn't great, but there you go. At 1440p in high settings, 60 FPS is no sweat. Of course, as with most open world games, there is an occasional drop of a frame or two, but the overall experience is very solid and it looks fantastic. Moving up to 4K, at high settings and 30 FPS, the Masher Pro does great. The amount of detail being resolved is pretty insane, and it makes the vast world of Los Santos look breathtaking at times. Of course, 30 FPS just doesn't do it for everyone, so the Masher Pro is also fine at 4K and medium settings and 60 FPS. While the regular Masher could barely manage this at the lowest possible settings, with frequent drops, the Masher Pro does great. Medium is still good enough that the overall visual experience is not that compromised, and the lowered input lag that comes with 60 FPS gameplay is always welcome. Fans of the series will of course remember that there's another game the Masher struggled with in a popular review, and it took a lot of work to get it looking good at 1080p. I'm of course referring to Oh yeah, we're looking at Doom again. The Masher required resolution scaling and a few setting tweaks to reach a stable 60 FPS in all areas, and while to me it still looks sharper and better than the PS4 version, it wasn't native 1080p and a lot of you took issue with that. For this benchmark, I went from the opening sequence through the first outdoor area to get a good mix of environments and lighting conditions. At native 1080p in the high preset, the Masher averaged 51 FPS and had a max of 78. The Masher Pro averaged 92 FPS and had a max of 150. I didn't benchmark any other resolutions on the Masher since it couldn't play them in the original video. But how does the Masher Pro do now? Well, on PC, Doom has a few settings above the very high setting. They're called Nightmare, and they're only available for shadows quality and virtual texturing page size. I enabled both and went to town. Here's the Masher Pro at 1080p, Nightmare, and of course a locked 60 FPS. It's not even sweating. Here's 1440p in Nightmare settings, still at 60 FPS, still not sweating that hard, still looking incredible. For grins, I dropped the resolution scaling to 80% and cranked up the sharpening a little since Doom has an excellent sharpening filter, and I turned off VSync. The Masher Pro stayed around 85 to 105 FPS and it was awesome. This is a truly PC experience. Blazing fast combat, gorgeous graphics, high resolution, and low input latency. This just isn't the same on a controller. But can the Masher Pro deliver a good 4K experience in one of the prettiest and fastest shooters this year? Yep. Now to be fair, this is at 80% resolution scaling, but I've found that at 4K output resolution, that usually looks pretty great in most games. Combined with a sharpening filter and at Nightmare settings, the Masher Pro stayed in the mid-50s and was locked at 60 a fair bit of the time. If you're wondering why I didn't just lower the settings a little and lock at 60 all the time, or bump back up to native resolution, honestly I was enjoying the graphics quality and I didn't feel the need to drop it for a few extra FPS. I do prefer a lock 60 in most games, but I had a great time in Doom. And yes, of course, the Master Pro can do a lock 60 at 4K on high settings or with a little lower resolution scaling, but I enjoyed this combination the most. It's sharp, it's beautiful, and it's one of the high water marks for modern shooters. In my view, it's a real 4K experience that doesn't feel cheap or watered down. If the PS4 Pro gets experiences like this, it'll do okay. But it's time to compare the Potato Masher Pro to the PS4 Pro directly, which means now we're going to take a look at a newer, more average game. Traditional Potato Masher Pro versus PS4 Pro reviews will be a little more in-depth, and of course longer, but for the purposes of this big intro video, we're just going to hit the highlights. And yes, there will be regular Potato Masher reviews of Titanfall 2 and Call of Duty Infinite Warfare coming soon, don't worry. Another year, another subpar Call of Duty port. To be fair, Infinite Warfare has had a smoother launch than last year's Black Ops 3, but I'm still not impressed. On PC, you used to have to click through each resolution option one at a time while your PC actually changed resolutions each time, kinda like Street Fighter V. That takes way too long and it's just ridiculous. Then it was patched during my testing so that you have this nifty list on the side, which would be great if all the resolutions fit on one page, which they don't, and that list apparently can't scroll, which doesn't really make sense and it also feels kinda lazy. Quite a few other menu options are this convoluted as well, and there aren't any good graphics presets, and a lot of the graphics options don't make a ton of sense, and they have varying levels that they can be turned up or down. So it's just frustrating, and again, it feels kind of lazy, and it speaks to the general lack of polish on the PC version. Still, after a longer than average setup, I was able to do some comparisons. The PS4 Pro uses dynamic resolution scaling, so it can go as high as 4K or as low as presumably 1080p. Because of all the film grain and other post-processing effects, as well as some fairly impressive filmic anti-aliasing, render resolution is hard to identify on both platforms. I am fairly confident the PS4 Pro isn't rendering anywhere close to 4K most of the time, but it's native 1080p or greater. Suffice it to say that both look decent, but I can't pin down when the PS4 Pro is dropping resolution. I mean, that's the general idea behind resolution scaling, so on the one hand that's good. On the other hand, I wasn't a fan of the strong post-processing, and I think it makes the overall image appear softer and more subdued than it needs to. Anyway, I can still identify some key differences with the Masher running at 1080p and very high settings. The Masher Pro is more ambient occlusion, although the PS4 Pro isn't bad. The Masher Pro is also running the highest tessellation preset, while the PS4 Pro is running on normal as far as I can tell. Most scenes appear to be lit the same, although I did find a few areas where the PS4 Pro does have fewer light sources, which isn't that uncommon for other PS4 games I've tested in the past. I can't really look at this scene and say that the PS4 Pro version looks worse, just different. On a technical level, the Master Pro does have more advanced lighting, but it's really very minor, and if you play both versions back to back, you probably won't notice it. The PS4 Pro also has lower resolution shadow maps, but neither platform has amazing shadows, so it's not a big loss. The Master Pro has more depth of field separation, which when combined with the greater ambient occlusion and tessellation, does give it a noticeable edge in the in-engine cutscenes, which look great on both platforms and have some really impressive animation and character models. Lastly, the Master Pro has more particle effects and accompanying bloom lighting. Most of these differences are only clear when you're moving slowly or you're looking, with the exception of particle effects. The game doesn't have that many slow sections, so it's not like you're missing out on crucial features with the PS4 Pro. Leaving 1080p behind, the Master Pro easily runs at 1440p in high settings, although in this outer space battle sequence you can see some very single-threaded bottlenecking happening on Core 4. This wasn't the case across most of the other missions I tested, so it may get patched, but it did cause a few frame drops at 1440p. The game still looks great, but the resolution bump isn't as noticeable as you'd think because of all the post-processing. Now at 4K with 80% resolution scaling, or roughly 1700p, and medium settings, it's a different story. Most of the settings that are turned down aren't as noticeable when you're playing, just like on the PS4 Pro, and it's enough of a resolution jump that you can appreciate the clarity and resolved detail. You can also see that Core 4 bottleneck happening at 4K in this outdoor space battle. It seems to be limited to just outdoor space battles, and it's only a frame or two, but it's still odd and I don't like it. Now, most people buy COD for multiplayer, so I did play quite a bit of that. Given the frenetic nature of the gameplay, I can't do any side-by-side graphics comparisons of the same exact situations. But at 1080p and very high settings, the Masher looks roughly the same as the PS4 Pro. The Masher Pro also does fine at 1440p in high settings, and 4K in high settings with the same 80% resolution scaling. If I was going to leave the Master Pro at 4K all the time, I'd probably leave the settings at medium to match the campaign, but it's capable of high in multiplayer due to the smaller maps and reduced complexity. No complaints on either platform. Now here's a last note on the resolution issue. I can force the Master Pro into 4K and record it at 1080p to judge performance and visuals in good enough quality for YouTube, but the PS4 Pro won't go into 4K mode unless it's connected to a native 4K display. I can't connect to my 4K monitor with my recorder intercepting the signal because it will detect it and drop back to 1080p. So I'm relying on sites like Digital Foundry to analyze resolution, and I'm basing my high resolution tests on that. Some games like Titanfall 2, which you'll see in a minute, run at clearly identifiable resolutions or the same resolution regardless of what mode the PS4 Pro is in, so I can easily detect that and do some good tests. Others like Call of Duty are much more variable, and it's frustratingly difficult to make definitive statements about its performance. Suffice it to say, both platforms look good. The Master Pro runs some of its effects and features a step or two higher, so it looks a little better. On a technical level, the Master Pro wins by a small margin. However, I would recommend this game on the PS4 Pro if you're considering a purchase. The multiplayer is traditionally better populated on PS4, partially due to Call of Duty's bad history with PC ports, and Call of Duty's just kind of a console game. The PC port for Infinite Warfare is better than in years past, but it's still not great, and I can't in good conscience recommend that you fight with it unless you have awesome hardware specs and you can brute force it. If you just want to play the campaign, then yeah, the Master Pro is the definite winner. But for multiplayer, just know what you're getting into, and personally I'd buy it on PS4. Titanfall 2 is using a great rendering solution for the PS4 Pro. Instead of separate modes for 1080p and 4K screens, everyone using a Pro will experience the same 1440p image with dynamic resolution downscaling and some great temporal anti-aliasing. In this game, framerate is more important than resolution, so it's great to see that the PC version also has the framerate targeting dynamic resolution scaling option. That's a mouthful. It can of course be disabled, but it works really well. So what does this mean? While on 1080p screens, the PS4 Pro delivers a very clean image with little to no visible aliasing or shimmer. That's rare for the traditional console gaming experience, and it's great to see. I can't make the PS4 Pro render the game at 1080p to show you the difference, but here's the Potato Masher Pro at 1080p compared to the PS4 Pro at 1440p. As you can see, while the resolution bump isn't life-changing or anything, it makes the image look much nicer. I'm a big fan of resolution supersampling, and I'm looking forward to testing this with future PS4 Pro releases, as I'm sure a few of them are going to use it. So with the Potato Masher Pro at 1440p and very high settings, I recorded some comparisons. While I can't do actual resolution counts, I compare diagonal edges in quite a few scenes, and it does appear that the PS4 Pro and the Potato Masher Pro both run at native res the majority of the time with very occasional drops. The drops aren't noticeable in actual gameplay only when I'm comparing them, so it's a win-win to me. Both platforms are sharp, clean, and they run great. So what are the differences? Well, as usual, the Potato Masher Pro has more ambient occlusion. The PS4 Pro either doesn't have any or it doesn't have enough to be noticeable. The same goes for atmospheric effects like smoke, fog, and haze. In indoor scenes, I can't tell any difference, but in outdoor scenes like the beginning of the campaign, the Master Pro has more depth and a more grounded look to the environment because of the ambient occlusion and atmospheric effects. The PS4 Pro also has much lower resolution shadow maps. In an unfortunate combination, the last negative to the PS4 Pro is the shadow pop-in. Shadows turn from an ugly blur to a slightly less ugly blur right in front of you as you approach them. This is much more minor on the Potato Masher Pro, and I would have gladly traded a little more resolution dropping on the PS4 Pro for cleaner handling of the shadows. Lastly, both platforms have a decent amount of pop-in for foliage and ground cover. I can't tell the difference between them, so it appears that they're running at the same level. One of the usual benefits of gaming on a PC is you can crank up the settings if your hardware supports it, and you can get rid of annoying things like pop-in. However, the overall game presentation is clean, sharp, and it runs well, so I'm really just being picky for the sake of this comparison. You might think the Potato Masher Pro has a large lead here, but there is one interesting downside that I don't think I've encountered in any other game test before. Because of the high amounts of ambient occlusion and atmospheric effects, which I like and they do look very nice, In some scenes, the Potato Masher Pro actually looks a little softer than the PS4 Pro. I checked a bunch of diagonal edges and I can't find any resolution difference, so I do think this is just a result of those settings. This is because the PS4 Pro has more visible hard edges that aren't tempered by the softened lighting. So that means that to match the PS4 Pro's clarity in these scenes, I'd have to actually drop the temporal anti-aliasing and a few other settings down a peg or two on the Masher Pro. Is this bad? No, not really, it's just interesting. So let's also talk about resolution. During the Witcher 3 section a few minutes ago, I mentioned that if you wanted to play on a 4K screen at 60 FPS, then 1440p was your best bet on the Potato Masher Pro. I played The Witcher 3 at 4K in very high settings, and 30 FPS on my 4K monitor when I actually just played it on my own. I did try 1440p and 60 FPS a few times, and while I liked the reduced input lag and great fluidity that came with the higher frame rate, I ended up choosing 4K and 30 FPS because it looked so crisp and beautiful. There is a big difference between 1440p and 4K. Here's 1080p to scale, then 1440p, then 4K. Big difference. But how big that difference will appear to you will depend on some variables, like the size and quality of your TV or monitor, the distance you sit from it, and a few other smaller details. I think the PS4 Pro delivers an excellent 1080p picture in Titanfall 2 because it's running at 1440p, but I'm less impressed by it running at 1440p on 4K displays. Sony loves to talk about its checkerboard rendering technique, but that's a big resolution jump and it is going to look a little soft on a 4K TV compared to real, native 4K. Fancy upscaling can only get you so far, at some point you actually have to render the pixels. So can the Masher Pro hit native 4K? Yes and no, but, you know, mostly no. Turning off resolution scaling, and in this opening scene that's pretty demanding, you can see that at 4K and low settings, the Masher Pro is not hitting 60 FPS. It's sharp, but it's way below 60. And 60 is important, so turning on resolution scaling will of course get us to 60, but the Masher Pro will be dropping resolution pretty often, so it's not like it's actually running at 4K most of the time in this sequence you've been watching. Sony might disagree, but in my view, just because something can occasionally hit native 2160p does not mean I'd consider this to be actually running at 4K. It's actually running somewhere in between 1440p and 4K. However, the Masher Pro can maintain a pretty solid 60 FPS at 1620p and low settings. This is another bump over 1440p, while still not native 4K. Still, it will make a difference on a 4K display and the game still looks decent at low settings. I mean, it still has more ambient occlusion and better shadows than the PS4 Pro. Oh yeah, and multiplayer's fine. Both platforms are running at 1440p with dynamic resolution scaling and neither have any issues. Both look good with the same general differences we looked at during the campaign. I did drop the Masher Pro to 1080p in high settings and I unlocked the frame rate and it was above 100 FPS for most of the time, so if you have a 96, 120, or 144Hz monitor, you can set an FPS target for the PC version hit above 60 FPS, but I can't test that to show you because I only have a native 60Hz display. Titanfall 2 was a great follow-up to one of the more unique multiplayer shooters of the past few years. I'm also happy to say it's a very solid release on both platforms. Are there differences? Yes, of course, but both platforms are impressively clean and stable. So while the Masher Pro is the winner, there aren't really any losers. I'd like to see better shadows on the PS4 Pro, but that's the only thing that stands out like a sore thumb. The rest of the experience is very good. So, some of you might be disappointed that the Masher Pro didn't just slaughter the PS4 Pro in this big opening video. I mean, that's the point, right? Well, no, not really. There will be some upcoming reviews that have larger disparities between the two versions, but honestly, the PS4 Pro is a decent system. Like I said earlier, I prefer to think of it as a more capable 1080p machine that dabbles in high-resolution gaming, and the Potato Masher Pro is fairly similar. Will it be superior in most games? We'll see, but I'm happy with how the Masher Pro is doing so far. If nothing else, you should be encouraged that old hardware can easily be upgraded to impressive new levels of performance without breaking the bank. I could have gotten most of the way here for less money. An RX 470 or a 3GB 1060 would be a great, even cheaper way to upgrade the Potato Masher or your budget PC, while still being fairly close or ahead of the PS4 Pro in performance. I look forward to continuing this series and I hope you enjoyed watching it. If you did, consider supporting my channel on Patreon. Not only can you get early access to new Potato Masher reviews, but I offer high quality video downloads if you want a pixel peep. You'll also be supporting me and the channel, and I do appreciate it. Thank you all for watching, liking, commenting, whatever you do. I will catch up with you in the comment section, and stay tuned for more.